Welcome to worship on Palm Sunday, Sunday of the Passion, April 10th, 2022. The following names have been added to the prayer list since it was printed: Joyce Minnissey and the family and friends of Dolly Romanoli. Do have some announcements today. After worship today, our annual Easter egg hunt will begin around 11:15. The great 3 days, the holiest time of the church year, will begin on sundown this Thursday. I invite and encourage you all to join us for worship. We will worship at 7 p.m. on Maundy Thursday, and again at 7 p.m. on Good Friday. On Easter Sunday, April 17th, we will have Easter Vigil worship outside at 6 o'clock a.m., and then regular worship inside at 9:45. These services will be recorded and shared online as usual. If you attend worship on Easter, I invite you to please bring bells or something else to ring. We do still need some helpers for these services, particularly the Easter Vigil service. There's a sign-up sheet in the narthex out on the counter. A free breakfast will be provided between the Easter services from about 7 to 9 a.m. If you're interested in attending the breakfast, it would be helpful if you sign up again out in the narthex today. You can still attend even if you don't sign up. Any questions, you can ask Lorraine Brands. Lorraine, did I miss anything?
No, if you brought anything, you just put it in the refrigerator for me, and that's all.
Okay. The deadline for thank you and thinking of you soldier cards will be June 5th. You can see Holly Blakesley for more information about that. On Sunday, May 1st, two very special things will be happening, and Martin, you can start coming forward to talk about one of them. First, we will have a guest preacher that morning. Reverend Lynn Rothrock, who was the very first pastor of Prince of Peace, will be visiting with us and preaching at the 9:45 a.m. service. We will hold a special coffee hour in his honor that day. Now, this is in the announcement folder, but the date is wrong in there. The correct date is May 1st, though certainly it's fine if you come the week before. And secondly, on Sunday, May 1st, we'll host a special concert. And Martin, you can come on up and tell us a little bit about that concert. Come on up to the pulpit.
Good morning and welcome to the beginning of the week that tells us who we are and why we are. One of the things that we've been able to arrange, thanks to the Church Show Fund and the Worship and Music Committee and the Jubilee Committee, is something that's really different, but really the same as what we always do. And the very personal part of it, I was sitting in Laura's living room, I was her vocal coach in Cleveland, and she said, "There's someone coming over tonight. Harpist." And I said, "Well, what's the harpist doing?" And he and I do duos. I did not flee, although I probably should have. This is a moment when we continue to feel, to understand. And a lot of times when something's very different, we hear it afresh. And when that evening in their living room, I heard a couple of opera arias that I had conducted, a dozen, some scores of times, and some of them hundreds of times, and hearing it with that tone, a harp and a soprano, made me rethink. So I'd like all of you to come, not because I'm shilling for a concert or taking up simony as a hobby, but because I believe that listening to things we know, some things we don't know, in a very fresh way, a way none of us, including me, had ever heard before, will touch our souls. Thank you.
Okay, what Martin didn't tell you is that this is a concert of a group called Harp and Heels. He didn't tell you that it's at 3:30 that day. He didn't tell you that you're all welcome. Martin, you're so good at philosophy and telling us why to come, but we also need to tell them what to do. So come on out Sunday, May 1st, 3:30 for this great concert. And Martin, I'm so glad you're here. There are flyers available for Harp and Heels out in the narthex. Please take one or more of these flyers with you today, and you can share them with friends and family or post them somewhere where you go in town. Georgia also has an announcement to make. Up here.
First thing before I forget, there is a calendar for signing up to host a coffee hour. There will not be coffee hour today because of the egg hunt, but the calendar in the back, so if you would like to schedule to do that one Sunday, it would be greatly appreciated. If you do have any questions, you could probably check with Carolyn. No? No, we can't check with Carolyn, but the sign-up sheet's back there, and you'll find somebody if you have a question. I'm not sure who to talk to. Yesterday, there was supposed to be a tractor pull at Johnson at Jacktown, and because of the weather, they decided that the tractors would probably get stuck in the mud. So Jackie was going to be serving sausage and pepper sandwiches, and she had gotten the sausage out to thaw and got the call. So here she had all this sausage that was already thawed out. So Jackie called me, she said, how about if we take the sauce, I make the sausage and peppers, and we take it down to Safe Harbor for lunch one day. So we were able to schedule that for Tuesday. We're going to be taking sausage and peppers and chips and some goodies for them down to Safe Harbor. But we could use some baked goods. They usually serve around 50 people at lunchtime. I know I'll be baking this afternoon, but if you could bake something, even if you can't bring it out to the church by Tuesday morning, if you call one, Jackie or myself, we'll make arrangements to come and pick it up. So we do need them for Tuesday morning. Thank you.
Okay. And what Georgia didn't tell you is that that's why the church smells like onions today. Okay, thank you for that. Finally and importantly, this is a special day in the church year. We begin worship today with the Liturgy of the Palms, remembering Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem the Sunday before his death. At the appropriate time, I will invite you to come forward to receive palms. You come forward as the ushers direct you, and Lorraine and I will hand palms to you. You can return to the pew via a side aisle. And then please remain standing at that point, singing the hymn that will be on the screens. You are welcome, of course, to take the palm with you, and there are also palms that have been folded into a cross out in the narthex. You're welcome to take one or more of those. We'll then move into the Liturgy of the Passion as we remember the suffering and death that Jesus accomplished for us. Today's gospel reading is the entire Passion story according to Luke. You will be invited to remain seated during that story, and there will be no sermon. However, since I encouraged you last week to ask questions about your faith, I invite you to take the opportunity today to ponder what questions this story brings up in you. There are index cards on your pews. I put a few on each end of the pews. And I invite you during the Passion story, or at any time during worship, write down a question you have about that, about your faith. There's a basket in the narthex on the way out where you can put those questions. I will attempt to respond to some of those questions in my sermons on Maundy, Thursday, Good Friday, and Easter Sunday. If you would like me to contact you directly about your question, just make sure you put your name on there. And if you're watching this on video, you can email me or call me with your question. And finally, at the end of the service today, the postlude will be Quincy Miller singing "Were You There?" I will invite you to be seated for the postlude and then to exit in silence. Let us worship the Lord. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Luke 19, the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he had come near Bethphage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.' So those who were sent departed and found it, and as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' They said, 'The Lord needs it.' Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. And as he now was approaching the path down the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven.' Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, order your disciples to stop.' He answered, 'I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out.' The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. We praise you, O God, for redeeming the world through our Savior, Jesus Christ. Today he entered the holy city in triumph and was proclaimed Messiah and King by those who spread garments and branches along his way. Bless these branches and those who carry them. Grant us grace to follow our Lord in the way of the cross, so that joined to his death and resurrection, we enter into life with you through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Let us go forth in peace in the name of Christ.
Amen.
Thank you.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Let us pray. Everlasting God, in your endless love for the human race, you sent our Lord Jesus Christ to take on our nature and to suffer death on the cross. In your mercy, enable us to share in his obedience to your will and in the glorious victory of his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. I invite the young and young at heart to bring your palms and come on up for story time. All right. Oops. Yeah. Great. Great. Good morning.
Good morning.
What do you have here? What are these things? Palms. These are branches from a palm tree, right? Do you know why we have these today? Anybody know? Because it's Palm Sunday. Yeah, today is a special day that's called Palm Sunday, and that's why we heard the story of Jesus riding into Jerusalem. The people were so happy to see him, they shouted Hosanna, and they waved palm branches, and they laid palm branches on the ground, like all these palms we have on the ground. But you know, everything changed after that. Soon, the people weren't happy anymore. Soon, they weren't waving palms at Jesus. They got angry at Jesus. They arrested Jesus, they put him on trial, and they put him to death on the cross. And so today changes too. It changed just a moment ago at the prayer of the day, and it's not called Palm Sunday anymore. Right now, today is called Sunday of the Passion. And the gospel story that we're going to hear in a couple minutes is the story of Jesus being arrested and tried and killed. It's a sad story, and we call this story the Passion of Jesus. So it's weird to change like this, isn't it? But, you know, sometimes we change too. Sometimes we're really good people. Who's a good person sometimes? And sometimes we're not. Who's not sometimes? Sometimes we follow Jesus really well. Do you ever follow Jesus really well sometimes? And sometimes we don't. Sometimes we do the right thing, and sometimes we do the wrong thing. But the story of the Passion shows us that Jesus went through so much for us, even though we're not perfect. Even though we mess up a lot. Who messes up a lot? Raise your hand if you mess up a lot. Yeah. Because this story isn't about how good or bad we are. It's about how amazing Jesus is and what Jesus did. Jesus did all this for you, and you, and you, and you, and you, and me. Because Jesus loves us so much. So today started very happy, and it gets sad then. The gospel story you're going to hear in a few minutes is sad, but it tells us who Jesus is. And I have a secret for you. The secret is this. This story actually has a very, very happy ending. We're not going to hear that happy ending today. We'll hear it next week. So make sure you come next week to hear that. But for today, just remember that Jesus loves you very, very, very much. Hey, let's bow our heads for a prayer. Dear God, in your love, you sent us Jesus. He became like us and died on the cross. Help us to share in his obedience and help us to share in his resurrection. Amen. Thanks so much. You can go back to your seats.
A reading from Isaiah. This text, the third of the four servant songs in Isaiah, speaks of the servant's obedience and persecution. Though the servant has been variously understood as the prophet himself or the remnant of the faithful Israel, Christians have often recognized the figure of Christ in these poems. The Lord God has given me tongue of the teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning, the Lord God wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult or spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint. And I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me, who will declare me guilty. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 31. Have mercy on me, O Lord, for I am in trouble. My eye is consumed with sorrow, and also my throat and my belly.
For my life is wasted with grief, and my years with sighing. My strength fails me because of affliction, and my bones are consumed.
I am the scorn of all my enemies, a disgrace to my neighbors, a dismay to my acquaintances. When they see me in the street, they avoid me.
Like the dead, I am forgotten, out of mind. I am as useless as a broken pot.
For I have heard the whispering of the crowd. Fear is all around me. They put their heads together against me. They plot to take my life.
But as for me, I have trusted in you, O Lord. I have said, you are my God.
Many times are in your hand. Rescue me from the hand of my enemies and from those who persecute me.
Let your face shine upon your servant. Save me in your steadfast love.
A reading from the Philippians. Paul quotes from an early Christian hymn that describes Jesus' humble obedience in his incarnation as a human being, even to death, and his exaltation and glory as Lord of all. Let the same mind be in you that was in Jesus Christ, Christ Jesus, who although being in the form of God, did not regard equally with God as something to be exploited, but relinquished it all, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form. He humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend. In heaven the Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father, the word of the Lord.
Thank you, God.
Passion of our Lord according to Luke. When the hour came, Jesus took his place at the table, and the apostles with him. He said to them, "I am eagerly desiring to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." Then he took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." He did the same with the cup after supper, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. But see, my betrayer is with me, and his hand is on the table. For the Son of Man goes as it has been determined, but woe to that one by whom he has been betrayed." Well, then they began to ask one another which of them it could be who would do this. And a dispute also arose among them as to which one of them would be regarded as the greatest. Well, Jesus said to them, "The kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors, but it is not so among you. For the greatest among you must become like the youngest, and the leader like one who serves. For who is greater, the one who is at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one at the table? Yet I am among you as one who serves. You are those who have stood by me in my trials, and so I confer on you, as my Father has conferred on me, a kingdom, so that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom. And you will sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Simon, Simon, listen. Satan has demanded to sift all of you like wheat. But I have prayed for you, that your own faith may not fail. And you, when once you've turned back, strengthen your brothers." Well, Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, I'm ready to follow you even to prison and to death." Jesus said to him, "I tell you, Peter, this day the cock will not crow until you have denied three times that you know me." And he said to them all, "When I sent you out without purse or bag or sword, did you lack anything?" They said, "No, not a thing." He said, "But now the one who has a purse must take it, and likewise a bag. And the one who has no sword must sell his cloak and buy one. For this scripture must be fulfilled in me, 'And he was counted among the lawless.' And indeed, what is written about me is being fulfilled." They said to him, "Look, Lord, here are two swords." He said, "It is enough." He got up and went out, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he reached the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not come into the time of trial." Then he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down on the ground, and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done." Then an angel from heaven appeared to him and gave him strength. In his anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling to the ground. When he got up from prayer, he found them asleep because of grief. And he said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not come into the time of trial." While he was still speaking, a crowd arrived, and the one called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He approached Jesus to kiss him, but Jesus said to him, "Judas, is it by a kiss that you betray the Son of Man?" When those around him saw what was coming, they said to him, "Lord, should we strike with the sword?" And one of them struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his right ear. But Jesus said, "Enough of this." And he touched the man's ear and healed him. Then he said to the chief priests and the officers of the temple guard and the elders who had come out for him, "Have you come out with swords and clubs as though I were a bandit? When I was with you day after day in the temple, you did not come for me. But this is your hour and the power of darkness. And they seized him and led him away, bringing him into the high priest's house. Now Peter was following at a distance into the courtyard of the high priest. And when they had kindled a fire in the courtyard and were sitting around it, Peter sat among them. Then a servant girl, seeing him in the firelight, stared at him and said, "This man also was with him." But Peter denied it, saying, "Woman, I don't know him." A little later, someone else, on seeing him, said, "This man is one of them." But Peter said, "Man, I am not." About an hour later, still another kept insisting, "Certainly this man is one of them, for he is a Galilean." And Peter said, "Man, I don't know what you're talking about." At that moment, while he was still speaking, the cock crowed. The Lord turned and looked at Peter. And Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said, "Before the cock crows, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly. Now the men who were holding Jesus began to mock him and beat him. And they blindfolded him and kept asking him, "Prophesy, who is it that struck you?" And they were also heaping many other insults upon him. When morning came, the whole assembly of the elders of the people, both chief priests and scribes, came together. And they brought Jesus before their council. They said to him, "If you are the Messiah, tell us." Jesus replied, "If I tell you, you will not believe. And if I question you, you will not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the power of God." Well, then they asked him, "Are you then the Son of God?" Jesus replied, "You say that I am." Then they said, "Why do we still need further testimony? We've heard it ourselves from his own lips." And the assembly rose as a body and brought Jesus before Pilate. They began to accuse him of many things, saying, "We saw this man perverting the nation, forbidding us from giving taxes to the emperor, and saying that he himself is the Messiah, a king." Well, Pilate asked Jesus, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus replied, "You say so." Then Pilate said to the chief priests and the people, "I find no basis for an accusation against this man." But they were insistent, saying, "He stirs up the people by teaching throughout all Judea, from Galilee where he started, even to this place." Well, when Pilate heard that, he asked whether the man was a Galilean. And learning that he was indeed under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him off to Herod, who was himself in Jerusalem at the time. Well, when Herod saw Jesus, he was greatly pleased, because he had been wanting to see him for a long time. He had heard about him and was hoping that he would see him perform some sign. Herod questioned Jesus at some length, but he gave no answer. The chief priests and the scribes stood by, vehemently accusing him. Even Herod, with his soldiers, treated him with contempt and mocked him. Then he put an elegant robe on him and sent him back to Pilate. That same day, Herod and Pilate became friends. Before this, they had been enemies. Well, then Pilate called together the chief priests, the leaders, and the people, and said to them, "You brought this man to me as one who was perverting the nation. And here I have examined him in your presence, and do not find him guilty of any of your charges against him. Neither does Herod, for he sent him back to us. Indeed, he has done nothing to deserve the sentence of death. I will therefore have him flogged and release him." But they all shouted, "Away with this fellow! Release Barabbas for us!" Now this was a man who had been put in prison for an insurrection that had taken place in the city and for murder. Well, Pilate, wanting to release Jesus, addressed the crowd a second time. But they shouted, "Crucify, crucify him!" Pilate spoke to them a third time, saying, "Why? What evil has he done? I find in him no grounds for the sentence of death. I will therefore have him flogged and release him." But they kept urgently demanding with loud shouts that he be crucified, and their voices prevailed. So Pilate gave his verdict that their demand should be granted. And he released the man they wanted, the one in prison for insurrection and murder, and handed Jesus over as they demanded. As they were leading Jesus away, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming in from the country. They laid the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A great number of the people followed, and among them were many women who were beating their breasts and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Rather, weep for yourselves and for your children. For the days are surely coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' And they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do this when the wood is green, what will happen when the wood is dry?" Two others who were criminals were also led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the two criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing. The people stood by and watched. And the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he is the Messiah, the chosen one of God." The soldiers also mocked him, offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." There was also an inscription over his head that said, "The King of the Jews." Now one of those who were hanged with him kept deriding him, saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you're under the same sentence of condemnation? And indeed, we are being condemned justly, for we're getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." And he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." It was about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m, as the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying in a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last. When the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God and said, "Certainly this man was innocent." And when all the people who had come for the spectacle saw what had taken place, they returned home beating their breasts. But all of his acquaintances, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance, watching these things. Now there was a good and righteous man named Joseph, who, though a member of the council, had not agreed to their plan in action. He was from the Jewish town of Arimathea, and he was waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate to ask for the body of Jesus. Then he took it down, wrapped it in a linen cloth, and laid it in a rock-hewn tomb where no one had ever been laid. It was the day of preparation, and the Sabbath was coming. The women who had come with him from Galilee followed, and they saw the tomb and how his body was laid. And then they returned to prepare ointments and spices. On the Sabbath, they rested according to the commandment. The Gospel of the Lord.
believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended to heaven.
He is seated at the right hand of God,
and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of
the
body,
and the life everlasting. Amen.
Drawn close to the heart of God, we offer these prayers for the church, the world, and all who are in need. We pray for the church called to follow Jesus in the way of the cross. Make us steadfast servants of the gospel. Guide the congregations of Prince of Peace and Christ Hamilton, Hamilton Square, and their pastors Michael Schultes and Stephen Claycomb, as they share the good news of Jesus Christ with all people, merciful God.
Receive our prayer.
For the earth and all of its inhabitants, created in love, teach us to recognize your divine goodness in the world around us. Awaken in us a reverence for creation, that we take greater care of its resources, merciful God.
Receive our prayer.
For those in positions of authority called to lead with integrity and compassion, supply them with courage when they face the challenge of new ideas. Increase their imagination to lead with justice for all people. Merciful God.
Receive our prayer.
For those celebrating birthdays this week, including Janet Pearson, Shirley Pencil, Samantha Gursky, Larry Smith, James Parson, Tyler Flight, Connie Itterly, may they have a very happy birthday and a year filled with good health and happiness. May they continue to know your boundless grace and love for them. Merciful God.
Receive our prayer.
For those who suffer, hoping for mercy and consolation, be with those who feel abandoned or betrayed. Defend those who are wrongly accused and embrace those who are incarcerated or detained. Bless the sick, bring comfort to the bereaved, including
Linda.
Joyce.
Shirley.
Bonnie.
Elwood.
And the family and friends of Dolly. Merciful God.
Receive our prayer.
For Christians around the world preparing this week to journey with Jesus to the cross, reveal to us once again that earth-shaking power of humble service, unmerited forgiveness, and sacrificial love. Lead us all from death to life, merciful God.
Receive our prayer.
Today we remember Mikhail Agricola, a Lutheran clergyman who was a prominent figure in the Reformation in Sweden and Finland. Remember us when you come into the kingdom and prepare a place for each of us with you in paradise. Merciful God.
Receive our prayer. Accept the prayers we bring, O God, on behalf of a world in need, for the sake of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
And share with one another a sign of Christ's peace. Peace be with you. Peace be with you.
Thank you.
Extravagant God, you have blessed us with the fullness of creation. Now we gather at your feast, where you offer us the food that satisfies. Take and use what we offer here. Come among us and feed us with the body and blood of Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, whose suffering and death gave salvation to all. You gather your people around the tree of the cross, transforming death into life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy God, our living water and our merciful guide, together with rivers and seas, wells and springs, we bless and magnify you. You led your people Israel through the desert and provided them water from the rock. We praise you for Christ, our rock and our water, who joined us in our desert, pouring out his life for the world. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his life, death, and resurrection, we await your salvation for all this thirsty world. Pour out your Spirit on this holy food and on all the baptized gathered for this feast. Wash away our sin, that we may be revived for our journey by the love of Christ. Through him, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, both now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Here is food and drink for the journey. Take and be filled.
Blessed Jesus, in this rich meal of grace, you have fed us with your body and the bread of life. Now send us forth to bear your life-giving hope to a world in need.
Amen.
Thank you.
You are children of God, anointed with the oil of gladness and strengthened for the journey. Almighty God, motherly, majestic, and mighty, bless you this day and always. Amen. Go in peace. Jesus meets you on the way. Thanks be to God. Please be seated for the postlude.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Oh, sometimes it causes me to tremble. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they nailed him to the tree? Sometimes it causes me to tremble. Were you there when they nailed him to the tree? Were you there when they pierced him in the side? Oh, sometimes it causes me to tremble. Sometimes it causes me to tremble. When they laid him
till